Hey guys, I'm Chris.
Hey everybody, I'm Robert.
And we're the Film Flamers.
And we are continuing our blockbuster talk by talking about a movie that may be a blockbuster, but it's certainly a sequel to one.
It's still a blockbuster. It didn't go gangbusters like the first one, but no. It still was very successful.
It made cash.
It did.
For sure. Of course, we are continuing our conversation into the Ring franchise by talking about The Ring 2, TWO.
Why? Why did they do that?
I don't know. That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard or seen.
Ugh. Well, The Ring TWO is a 2005 American psychological supernatural horror film and sequel to the 2002 film The Ring. Hideo Nakata, director of Ringu, the Japanese film in which the American versions are based, which is also not the original Ring movie, like most people think, directed this film in place of Gore Verbinski. Naomi Watts, David Dorfman, and Daveigh Chase reprised their roles, with Simon Baker, Elizabeth Perkins, and Sissy Spacek joining the cast. Although Daveigh Chase, I believe, is only in little bit pieces, most of which from the first movie.
Yeah, I guess you can sort of tell a difference, because she spends a lot of more time out of the video in this movie.
Yeah.
So, while the adapted screenplay of both The Ring and The Ring 2 was written by Erin Kruger, most of the creative team behind the first film was not involved in this one, including the incredible talents of Hans Zimmer for the music or cinematographer Bohan Bazili. And it shows. Wah, wah.
Okay, listeners. We're not your fucking mother. This is The Ring TWO.
We didn't do anything wrong. We did what anyone would do.
It's all for honey.
She's not coming back.
How do you know that?
Have you ever seen something so scary that you had to show it to someone else?
Hey.
I want to show you something.
They found a body.
The guy was dead on the living room floor, right in front of the TV.
The tape. Did you watch it?
They keep talking about his face.
I found you.
Her name's Samara. She was murdered, left to die at the bottom of a well. But she didn't die.
What's happening?
I know this sounds completely crazy. She wants to be him.
Honey, don't you think you should sleep?
You have to do it. You have to send it back.
Aiden!
They stopped me.
Open the door, honey!
Rachel, no!
Don't let them stop you.
I have to show you something.
Six months after the events of the first film, and following the events of the short film Rings, not to be confused with the feature-length film that would come much later, Samara Morgan's cursed videotape has been circulating through teenagers in Astoria, Oregon. Teen Jake Pierce is on the seventh day of his march toward death and asks his friend Emily to watch the tape. He briefly steps into the kitchen while Emily supposedly watches the tape, because reasons. Jake notices dark liquid pouring from under the kitchen door and runs outside to the living room, only to discover Emily had closed her eyes while watching the tape like a little bitch baby. Jake is then promptly murdered by Samara, played by Kelly Stables. Rachel Keller, played by Naomi Watts, and her crotch fruit Aiden, played by David Dorfman, have moved to Astoria from Seattle after presumably sending the tape off to a popular movie rental store that rhymes with Mockmuster. Allegedly. Rachel works at the Daily Historian for editor in... Rachel works at the Daily Historian for editor daddy-in-chief Max Work, played by Simon Baker. Rachel learns of Teen Jake's death and promptly travels to the scene of the crime, stares down the sole surviving victim, Emily, before breaking into an ambulance to inspect Jake's body. What a nosy bitch. Not to be outdone by Rachel's shitty sense of empathy and timing, Samara appears, declaring that she has been looking for Rachel. Unfazed, Rachel breaks into Jake's house, obtains a videotape, and burns it in a barrel by a van down by the river. As the videotape burns in all its Muppety glory, Aiden experiences a nightmare where Samara drags him into a television. He soon starts developing hypothermia and obvious hand-shaped bruises on his arms and back. Later, at the county fair, for some reason, Aiden wanders into a restroom and takes photographs of his reflection because reasons, where Samara appears. Rachel finally finds him and takes him home, but they are attacked by wild deer on the way. As Rachel pulls away in horror, even more deer come. She panics, and a deer with gigantic antlers runs into her car. The deer runs into her car 10 times. Deciding not to react so Muppety, Rachel slowly pulls the car away so as to not spook the deer too much more. After Rachel and her demon semen leave the scene, a doe gives birth to a fawn named Bambi, who will one day take over the position of Great Prince of the Forest, who guards the woodland creatures. Bambi grows up very attached to his mother, with whom he spends most of his time. The fawn is befriended by an eager, energetic rabbit named Thumper, who helps teach him to walk and speak. A young skunk he mistakenly calls Flower, who is so flattered he keeps the name, and a female fawn named Faelene. Curious and inquisitive, Bambi frequently asks about the world around him and is cautioned about the dangers of life as a forest creature by his loving mother. One day, out in the meadow, Bambi briefly sees the great prince on a cliffside far above them, but does not realize that it's his father. Normally, at this point in the story, the great prince would have warned the deer below about the approaching hunters, but unfortunately, he was hit 7 times by Rachel's car. I can do nothing but watch this Bambi's mother, and all the other deer shot to death by, I don't know, Dick Cheney. So all the deer die because of that stupid bitch Rachel. What? Meanwhile, rocket scientist Rachel realizes Aiden may be possessed by Samara. I like how that's a whole fucking paragraph. Fuck. Not wanting to return home for some reason, Rachel goes to work, only for Max to take them in, also because of reasons. While Rachel is attempting to give Aiden a bath to warm him up instead of going to a hospital like a normal parent, she goes to a fucking textbook. He develops an irrational fear of water. Samara causes the water to recede from the bath, replacing Aiden with herself and terrorizing Rachel so that she tries to drown Samara, even though she's already dead. Max enters, seeing her drowning Aiden instead, and forces her to take her son to the hospital. Like a normal parent. Based on Aiden's obvious little girl-sized-shaped bruises. This movie. Psychiatrist Emma Temple, played by Elizabeth Perkins, suspects child abuse on the part of Rachel for some reason, and she sends Rachel away. Looking for answers and a quick pick-me-up, Rachel terrorizes another horse on the ferry to Moesco Island, where she eventually finds evidence of Samara's biological mother, Evelyn, played by Sissy Spacek, who tried to drown her as an infant. Rachel visits Evelyn at a psychiatric hospital, who advises her to listen to her baby when it inevitably asks its mother to drown it. Because reasons. Back at the hospital, Samara takes control of Aiden's body and telepathically forces Dr. Temple to commit suicide before returning to Max's house. Max arrives suspects foul play and tries to secretly take photos of Aiden just in case Rachel isn't an insane and abusive mother raving about ghosts. Rachel arrives, discovering an affectionate Aiden waiting for her, but acting suspiciously out of character, she steps out, finding Max's orgasm-faced corpse in his pickup truck. Tired of all this spoopy nonsense, Rachel goes back inside and falls asleep. Dreaming of Aiden, who tells her that she will have to exorcise Samara by drowning him because reasons. Upon awakening, Rachel drugs Aiden Samara with sleeping pills. Fucking peanut butter and Vicodin sandwich. And places him her to temporarily drown him or them. Samara leaves Aiden, but reappears inside the television. Thinking she must sacrifice herself to save Aiden, because reasons, Rachel allows herself to be dragged into Samara's monochromatic world. Finding herself at the bottom of the well Samara died in, Rachel discovers the lid is partially open. She scales the walls walls, pursued by Samara, but escapes by climbing out and pushing the lid shut on Samara, locking her out of her and Aiden's lives, because that's what Rachel has decided has happened. Wandering through the woods, she comes to the cliff where Samara's adoptive mother, Anna, had originally committed suicide. Hearing Aiden's voice, Rachel falls off the cliff and falls into the water, returning to the real world and reuniting with Aiden. Rachel is promptly arrested for child endangerment, cruelty to animals, and accessory to murder, with authorities citing a trail of bodies spanning two states and the deaths of at least six minors. Aiden is placed into foster care, where he is eventually paired with a responsible adult. Allegedly.
The end.
Oh my god, we haven't even gotten into the movie and my fucking face hurts. Fuck me with that.
I almost put the entire synopsis of Bambi in there.
I mean, I have to take a breath. And here I thought I laughed really hard at this movie when I was watching it. Fuck.
Hold on. No, when you're writing
beer.
Yeah. When you're writing the synopsis, you realize just how absurd it is.
It like, really is fucking
hilariously
ridiculous.
Absurd.
Just ridiculous. Which is why I told my friend and patron Alex last night, watch this movie right away. You have to do it. Just do it right now.
She really goes outside, discovers the dead body, and goes back inside. Instead of like confronting the child, she's just like, I'm going to sleep now.
Yeah.
It's not quite that simple, but I mean, like, really.
I mean, it kind
of is. That's the plotting.
Like, every step of this movie, I'm just like, why is this happening? And, like, I'm not sure this is quite protocol for anything. I'm like...
For reality? Or...
I feel like in 2005, someone can't walk into a hospital room and be like, you're no longer his mother, or whatever, you know? I don't know. The whole thing's silly. Let's get into it.
So, The Ring 2 was released on March 18th, 2005, 4 months later than it was originally planned. Although it was met with generally negative critical reception, it opened in the United States with a strong $35 million in its first weekend, more than doubling the opening weekend of The Ring. Its final $76 million domestic gross was less than the original $129 million, but it did take $87 million internationally, for a total gross of $164 million against a budget of $50 million. Versus $250 million total gross against $48 million in the original.
Yeah, the original really was a fucking blockbuster. That movie, and of course, when a movie makes that much money, like the sequel is going to make money. At least the first sequel, you know? If we ever get around to talking about Rings, or maybe I'll just look this up.
And this one made over three times its budget, you know?
Yeah, it's still made money.
Yeah.
But, is it a movie?
Mm-hmm.
On Rotten Tomatoes, the film has an approval rating of 20% based on 189 reviews with an audience score of 33%. The site's critical consensus states, Ring 2 serves up horror cliches, and not even Hideo Nakata, the director of the film from which this one is based, can save Ring 2 from a dull screenplay full of absurdities.
Metacritic assigned the film a weighted average score of 44 out of 100 based on 37 critics, indicating mixed or average reviews. Audiences polled by CinemaScore give the film an average grade of C+ on an A+ to F scale.
And I feel like the original one, it was just a B+, right? So, I mean,
something, yeah.
Yeah. Roger Ebert considered it better than the first film, giving it 2.5 stars. He said, quote, "The charm of Ring 2, while limited, is real enough. It is based on the film's ability to make absolutely no sense, while nevertheless generating a real enough feeling of tension a good deal of the time."
I feel like he must have been in a mood during the first one.
He had to have.
Because his review didn't make sense for that one.
No, it didn't.
And it doesn't make sense for this one.
Really doesn't make sense.
It kind of actually makes sense. This makes sense. What doesn't make sense is that he liked it better than the first.
Yeah.
That's insane to me. But, you know. One of the top Letterboxd reviews states, "Samara, you're dead. Just get over it."
We need to start doing this.
I know. Like, usually Letterboxd has some gold. And that was like, literally, it was just, "Samara, you're dead. Just get over it."
She can't, though. The film has some accolades. What?
I scraped the bottom of the internet barrel and I found some.
Okay. It was nominated at the Teen Choice Awards for Best Thriller, Movie Screen Scene, I guess from Naomi Watts, and Scary Scene, The Deer.
It was also nominated the Golden Schmoes and the Stinkers Bad Movie Awards for Worst Movie of the Year and Biggest Disappointment of the Year.
Okay.
It didn't even win those.
Well, damn. And at Russia's MTV Movie Awards, it was nominated for Best International Movie.
Russia's MTV Movie Awards. Oh, that's sad.
Oh, that's sad. Accolades indeed.
All the almost accolades.
As we mentioned earlier in the episode, this is the second movie in this franchise. And there is, in fact, a movie that I consider to be way worse than this one. And it's called Rings.
Yep.
From 2017. So there's a little bit of legacy.
Yeah, and I'm still probably not going to watch that.
I think you should at this point.
Just for funsies?
Yeah.
I don't know. Is it like hilariously bad or is it just bad?
Because
it sounds like from what you've said, it's just bad.
Yes, is the question. I think it depends. So like when I watched The Rings back in 2017 when it came out, I was not stoned and I have not seen it since. And I like actively hated myself for days after waiting to watch that movie. And now I feel like with the right amount of gummy and maybe a couple beers, I might have a better time watching it.
Okay.
But right. It's not good by any means.
All right. Maybe I'll subject myself to that tonight.
I mean, if you actively sat down and watched that Poltergeist remake that you didn't want to watch like 10 years after it came out, then
yeah. You
might as well watch Rings. I mean, nothing can hurt you now that you've seen the Poltergeist remake.
I also don't really care about the Ring franchise like I do the Poltergeist.
I will
which
say,
shouldn't be a franchise because it's just one fucking movie.
It is. I know. But I mean, like, since our last recording and watching the first Ring again after so many years of not having seen it, like, I feel like I'm fully invested. Like, I kind of want to read all the books, watch all the things, and, like, just do the Ring. Like, do the damn thing.
Yeah.
Right? I'm kind of in that place right now in my life.
Okay. Well, a lot of our cast came back. Obviously, Naomi Watts and David Dorfman as Rachel and Aiden, mother and son. Although there's a newcomer here, our new daddy is Simon Baker.
Yeah.
Who's been in a lot. And he went on to do, The Mentalist.
He was on The Mentalist.
He was The Mentalist.
Yes.
And Kelly Stables came in as Samara Morgan. I think she was doing stunts, you know, like the legs over the arms kind of crawling for the first movie. And so she just came back in and played this one because I guess she's a woman that's of that kind of stature.
Okay.
Or she could pull it off. But the original, Daveigh Chase, had kind of aged out.
So this one did like the contortionist parts of the original,
I guess.
Maybe.
But it doesn't look like she's that much older,
No.
You know, so I don't know.
I mean, she looks angry.
Yeah, but they still use Daveigh Chase in the archival footage from The Ring,
okay.
You know. Shockingly, which I didn't know going in to see this movie in the theaters, was Sissy Spacek.
Yeah, I feel like that's something you might want to advertise.
Yeah, they were probably hoping that it would be like a big moment, you know.
Oh,
you know, Carrie herself
mm-hmm.
coming in. But she just, you know, I feel like almost anyone could have done that.
Yeah,
I mean, it didn't need to be Sissy Spacek.
They kind of go out of the way to make her not look like Sissy Spacek.
Yeah.
They put that Samara-esque black wig on her, and she's in it for about 6 seconds. And yeah, and she doesn't really do anything.
Yeah, it also felt like it's like telling too much story, you know, because like my mind was going in interesting places. Like, where did this child come from? And it like over explains.
Yeah, a little bit,
you know.
Oh, a lot of it, actually.
So I don't know. And then we've got Elizabeth Perkins as Dr. Emma Temple.
I always like Elizabeth Perkins. I mean, she has that cunty bitch face.
Oh, I don't know. I think she's pretty.
She's pretty, but she always looks like she's perturbed.
Something about her line delivery is kind of cutty.
Yeah, I mean, in this movie for sure, or in lots of things that she's in.
She's like, what kind of doctor are you? She's like, a psychologist. Yeah. She's kind of, yeah.
And here's what I have to say.
Great.
What a subpar death scene that was, too, though.
Yeah, I was like, Matt, could that happen? He's like, if she hit an artery, maybe, because she just injects air.
Yeah. Well, right. I mean, I know that that can cause what, like, an
injury. Of course, that's how, like, you know, Ian McKellen killed himself in Apt Pupil.
That's true.
Kind of.
Yeah. The exact same.
Of course, his was already in one, you know, in a vein, but she was doing it blind, like into her neck, you know.
She was a doctor, Chris.
She was a psychologist. She doesn't know how to, like, inject shit.
She went to medical school.
Did she?
Yeah.
Psychologists do?
She had a white coat on.
Okay, you're fucking
on
me.
No. One of them do. I don't know. Psychiatrist, psychologist, one of them go to medical school.
She worked for CPS. I mean, come on.
I mean, essentially, she was just like, no, you're not his mom anymore.
Okay. I was like, yeah. That's, again, like the first movie had a little bit of this problem. So like, no one knew how she died with her heart just stopping. And I'm like, did they look at her face? Like the makeup department in the script, right? And yet again, this kid has like little girl sized handprints all over him. And it's the mom. Like,
I think it's safe to say both in this movie and the previous one, the original, right, that Rachel is not the best mother, like you said in the synopsis.
No, she's trying to sleuth her way through his illness, like hypothermia, like the stupid temperature on the thing when he was finally in the hospital showed like 90, and Matt's like, dead.
She pulls out a fucking textbook instead of like doing something, like take him to the fucking hospital.
And he's like upright and talking to her.
Yeah.
And she's like, ooh, you're freezing. And it's like right next to her head is like 90 degrees.
It's like we're watching Death Becomes Her. But they took her to the hospital in Death Becomes Her. So, I mean, like, come on. But the thing is, I mean, like, you don't have to look very far, Dr. Emma Temple, to accuse this woman of being an unfit mother. But she's looking at all the symptoms in the hospital. And I'm like, no, like, there's more than this. But whatever.
The kid's got hypothermia that you can't cure. Something else is going on.
Clearly. But... And it's just like, I don't know. I feel like this entire movie, and we haven't really even started talking about it, is just ridiculous.
Well, it's kind of a cluster, and that's probably going to be uncovered a little bit when we start talking about the movie and how it was made, the background.
Okay, let's do that.
Right. So this was directed by Hideo Nakata, which probably took, you know, put a lot of cred and hopefulness about this movie because he directed Ringu, which a lot of people would say, oh, he directed the original Ring, which he did not. Yet again, that was like another remake of a remake of a book.
Well, I think for like all intents and purposes, though, that was the first really successful version, right? I mean, at least
the original
Japan.
Ring. Yeah, Ringu. Yeah, Ringu. Sure. It was very successful. But more to the do with the story than how it was made, you know?
I totally forgot that he directed this movie at this point, but I remember this movie coming out, and by then I had seen The Ring, the American one, and I had seen the Japanese movie, and I was just like, oh my God, you're right.
Well, he also directed Ringu 2, which was also shitty, the Japanese version, right? So he directed two shitty sequels to his original, basically. So it's weird already to direct a sequel to a remake of your own movie, which was also a remake of another movie based on a book. But here we are.
Yeah.
Right. So Ringu seems to be his highest rated film, and most of the others aren't nearly rated as high. Right. So I think he kind of struck gold with the story and knew how to, you know, he's a competent director, a competent and technical director, I think.
Oh, for sure.
You know, and so Hideo Nakata barely spoke any English during production. So when the situation called for it, he had a translator on set to help communicate with the cast and crew. Mm-hmm. So already we've got an issue. Right. So based on a bunch of like studio involvement, he tried to leave the production of Flee to Japan.
Oh my God. Flee?
But he stayed out of, you know, just out of respect for the cast and the crew.
How very
but
Japanese.
It makes me wonder if he stayed in that like extra 4 months that the movie was delayed, whether that was a business decision based on other releases. I don't know. But it makes me wonder if he didn't stay to oversee any editing, or if the studio did, which seems to be the case based on everything we're seeing. It's like, hey, we've got this big successful franchise, all the studio eyes are on it, versus, hey, this is like something greenlit that's coming out. It could be a big hit, but most of the studio and executives are off of it, right? And so that's kind of like the first movie. Now that it's a big, important franchise, and it was such a big hit, you've got all these eyes on it, and you've got too many cooks in the kitchen, right? And he is, from this experience, he has sworn never to go and do any kind of business or direction in the U.S. again, based on his experience doing this.
And I would say that's probably the best thing to do.
And that they interfered with essentially everything, like made him reshoot things. It didn't have to, like, it didn't match like his original vision for things. And they ended up probably doing the editing and doing a bunch of other things. And so, like, this is just a big studio fuck up where they just got in the way of everything else and didn't want to pay for as much so they could make even more money by, you know, not getting the cinematographer back, not getting the original director back who didn't like the script, not getting the Hans Zimmer back, right? And so they tried to, like, copy of a copy, ironically, everything, right? And so the cinematography is by Gabriel Beristain instead of Bohan Bozzelli. The music was by Henning Lohner and Martin Tillman versus Hans Zimmer. And so we've got all these, like, replacement people that don't know quite what they're doing. I think they helped out, like, as associate music producers with Hans Zimmer on the first one, and that's why they got the job. But they're using the wrong themes at the wrong times. Like the witch theme that he's using as a homage in Suspiria that uses only at certain times, They're using as she drives her car down the road.
Yeah, it's stupid.
Right? And so, like, in the opening sequence, they actually edit, I don't know if this is a studio, when Jake and Emily go indoors, there's an extremely recognizable piece by James Newton Howard's score from The Sixth Sense used there.
Randomly. In the actual movie?
Randomly, yes.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. So, like, they kept the temp track in. Which is tough.
Yeah, so I can see where this movie starts to fall apart before it's even released or completely finished, right? So, I mean, all that starts to, like, add up.
Yeah.
And the thing is, I mean, like, if he's saying he swears not to make another movie in Hollywood or the US or whatnot, I can assume in other countries that things like what happens in Hollywood, like, this happened there too, right? And in countries like India that make a shit ton of movies every year, I would imagine that they make sequel upon sequel of things. I'm not an expert. I don't know. But, I mean, I think it's fairly prevalent in America. And you got to feel a certain kind of way when you're asked, even if you're a replacement for someone else, to step in and helm a movie that you've essentially directed before. And you're like, oh, I have a chance to, like, make this movie again, show it to a different audience. And if it just not working out or whatever, I could see swearing off an entire career in another country.
Yeah.
Also, I can imagine how difficult it is to direct people when you don't speak their language.
Yeah. So it's already fish out of water, already language barrier, already there's technical constraints there. And then you've got kind of a script no one's happy with, you know, and, you know, a bunch of other cost cuttings and studio interference. It's just like, it's not the best example of, like, a magical movie making experience And I hope that he would understand that. It's not just indicative of the American movie making experience.
No, we're not all like this, you know. But, and also, this also makes me think about Ju-on again, Ju-on and The Grudge, right? So that director who directed Ju-on came to America and directed the American version of The Grudge. And
he's a better director.
Yeah, well, yes, for sure. He made a spectacularly different version of a movie that he already made, right? It's like he came in and he was just like, I'm going to make this for American audiences.
But not an obvious version.
But no, but he also stayed true to his version and stayed true to his culture in a way.
Yes, it was in Japan. And it just added an extra layer of fish out of water from the American standpoint of not being able to speak the language and everything else.
But it's a very smart director to come in and do something like that to the work that you've already made. He was like, I have an opportunity to tell the same story, but differently and do it in a good way.
You just want to talk about The Grudge.
I do want to talk about The Grudge.
I don't know if he actually wrote that. You know,
he may not have.
You know, or maybe he signed off on it. I don't know.
We'll find out later on.
Yeah, we're gonna deep dive that in about a year from now, right?
I clearly have a boner for
I've already added it to the docket.
I guess we'll keep talking about The Ring too, so we can move ever closer to that moment. Fine.
But overall, this whole movie, you know, has a feeling of cutting costs and riding on franchise fame by the studio versus actually trying to make a good movie. And, like, a lot of franchises, the studio gives it lots of attention now that it was a potential moneymaker. And so a lot of stuff in the first movie doesn't make sense, but the direction overall tone achieved by the direction, cinematography and editing and music, amazing, achieved an intentional sense of mystery versus what we have here seems very like paint by numbers based on the script with very little nuance or visual storytelling, at least relative to the first film. Like Naomi Watts didn't want to reprise her role after reading the script, but she had to begrudgingly do so after being forced by contractual obligations. And later on, Hideo Nakata has disowned this film completely and claims to hate it. And he blames the film's negative reception from both fans and critics on the studio interference we just talked about, as the Paramount executives would step in during the shoot and either force him to reshoot key sequences, delete certain scenes, or change existing scenes until they bore little resemblance to what Nakata had in mind.
And I know that there's like, when this movie came out on DVD, because I was still working in Blockbusters at the time, and there was like an unrated cut.
Yeah.
That was on DVD. And so I saw this in the theater and I was just like, oh Lord. Right. And I didn't really care for it.
No.
You know? And so I never rented the movie and watched it again. I didn't care enough to see why it was unrated, you know? So I don't know what scenes were cut out, you know, but
unrated is a marketing term.
Yeah. For real.
I mean, it's like too nasty to rate or whatever, obviously.
There couldn't have been anything in this. I mean, they had a very successful horror movie that was rated PG-13 the first time around.
There's extended scenes, like you actually see Samara go into his body.
Oh, God.
In the bathroom.
Okay.
And a couple of other things. And there's a couple of them, like different music cues, and that's it.
Okay. Right, right.
Yeah.
But I get where Naomi Watts is coming from, because out of this entire movie compared to the other one, her character has changed quite a bit, and I like her a lot less in this movie.
She seems dumber.
She does seem dumber. She was smart. She was savvy in the first one, and even though she had bad parenting skills a little bit, she seemed like a better mom.
And it doesn't seem to make any sense that she would move out.
No,
to the like a lot of the premise is based on the different type of character that she is.
Yeah, she's a different person. And the thing is, I mean, like, it's supposed to be 6 months after the original events, right? And no one changes that quickly in 6 months. And also, they should be suffering from the most extreme PTSD.
Yeah.
And I can watch a movie and suspend my disbelief as far as like real world things go. But I was having a hard time with this one. I was just like, none of it makes sense. Their actions do not make sense.
I would have loved to see the real world consequences that grounds the film. Like all of the investigation that had to have happened after all that with all those bodies and stuff. Other franchises have done it and managed to do really, really well to catapult from the grounded basis into even a new height of like fantasy. Like take Terminator 2, the beginning of that fucking film, she's in an asylum.
Yep.
Right.
At the very least, why do they have a fucking TV in their new house?
Yeah.
You know, why do they have a fucking VHS player?
Yeah.
You know, I don't understand. And so, I mean, even the Poltergeist sequel, they don't have a fucking TV.
No. At the very end, during the credits of Poltergeist, he pushes the fucking TV out of the hotel room.
And then in Poltergeist 2, they're like, we don't have TVs.
Nope.
You know? And so, I mean, like, even that makes more sense. Even Poltergeist 2 is not the best fucking, it's a kind of a terrible movie. But like,
they moved, even though they know she can show up anywhere, especially out of a fucking TV.
And they're kind of surprised that she's there too. You know? I mean, like, and the whole time, like, Rachel's like, oh no, not again. Like at the beginning. And I'm like, Jesus. I mean, like, it's just annoying.
Yeah.
Kind of. So I get it. I get it, Hideo. You can disown the movie. I probably would too. But.
Well, it's just interesting. Like, I wonder how much of the actual sequel this is based on, because theoretically, or like, it still says it's based on the first book.
Yeah.
Like, if this is actually just like a continuation of the first book, we've got to read it. And then the sequel book, Spiral, is what Rings is based on, theoretically, loosely.
So I'm on it. I'm doing this. I'm doing this thing.
Okay.
I'm going to read this book. I'm going to try to read all of them.
Okay.
And I know I say that, but I'm serious about this. Like, okay. I'm wrapped up in this Ring shit. I'm going to do it all.
Sweet.
I'll report back.
Thank you.
I will.
So one thing that's interesting to me, there's still some value in this movie, right? There's still some really cool, you know, set pieces and some cool ideas. And at the beginning, it actually kind of reminds me of It Follows, yeah, where the boyfriend is desperate to get this chick to watch this movie. Like he's trying to spread this, you know, STD that gets removed from him, you know, once he does that. You know, it just really reminded me of that trying to force the It Follows spirit or ghost or demon or whatever the fuck it is, the sexually transmitted demon.
Mm-hmm.
you know, PS2. And I'm wondering, like, could this, like, J-horror and other things that I have not seen actually kind of be the birthplace of something like It Follows?
I would say so.
It feels very J-horror now that I think about It Follows.
It does. I mean, because I feel like a lot of Japanese horror movies deal with curses, right? Like, obviously, we've already talked about The Grudge. And then we have things like Pulse, you know what I mean? And,
yeah.
And it's all about, like, ghosts and curses and that sort of thing. And so it's very much like It Follows in this case because they know what they need to do at this point, right? Show someone else the thing, make a copy, show someone else.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, the people who are watching this urban legend have already, like, figured it out so they can do it, right?
It also shifts it because before, the understanding from the previous film was that you make a copy in your safe, not show it.
Show it to somebody else. I know. I mean, because when I was watching this, I was just like, well, they've added a layer.
Yeah.
You know?
And yet again, it's just like they're going for this disconnect between the script and what they're showing on screen. And I wish like a writer-director, I love writer-director combos sometimes because everything's going to be like congealed into one. Like everything makes sense. Yeah. Like the kid's waiting in the fucking kitchen. His life is on the line for her to watch it. And he's not going to like sit there with her. Like he's not going to make sure she's watching it. Like,
well, he's antsy.
What is going on? Like, you know, it doesn't make sense to me, but yeah. Like, and that sort of thing happens all throughout this movie. Why aren't you taking the kid to the hospital? Why'd you go to the fucking office? Why are you going home with this guy? Nothing's like special about your home. Like,
I know why,
you know, the kid has hypothermia. Why?
Because reasons.
Oh, that's true. I forgot. And I wrote that. So but, I don't know.
No, I mean, I totally can see that now that you've mentioned it, right? And it makes a lot of sense. And I feel like even things like Talk to Me, like we talked about in the last episode, like sort of stem from this J-horror cursed object kind of thing where you have this urban legend and like people think they're savvy enough to do it and survive and then they can't, especially in the first part of this movie, at least with that kid.
Yeah.
What did Alex call him? He called him like cheap Pete Wentz or something. Like that. Also, that girl from the beginning of this movie is like one of my favorite TV actresses from that time period. She was in a show called Brothers and Sisters that I liked very, very much. Hmm. And then later on, she was on a show called Revenge.
Okay.
And I totally forgot that she was in this. And so I'm watching it. I'm like, Brothers and Sisters. You know, I'm like, that's my main takeaway from the opening of this movie. That was the most important thing about it, apparently.
Yeah. Well, she, yeah, obviously there's this breaking into the ambulance thing, which is just like, what the fuck are you doing? But she gets the fucking tape, and then we get that Muppety videotape death.
Oh my God, that was my favorite fucking part. Because she like rips the fucking tape out of it. She throws both the film and the actual like cassette housing into the fire that she starts herself in that barrel. And it creates a little mouth and then it screams. And I was just like, what? I was laughing so hard. I was just like, I can't. Like, if this is any indication about the rest of this movie, because I'd completely forgotten everything that happens, I was like, we're either in for a treat or I'm going to be real fucking pissed off.
Right? Yeah. I want that sort of thing to be consistent. Like, I want Bruce Campbell to show up on the side as a homeless guy and be like, having a rough day or something like
that. Exactly. Like, if you're going to make a movie this fucking ridiculous and this absurd, like, at least have a little tongue in cheek with it. But it's like, oh, it's opening its fucking mouth and screaming at you. And I was just like, oh, I love that little tape. But unfortunately, it goes into the direction of I just get real pissed off.
Taking itself too seriously.
Yeah. I mean, but it does. And it's, ugh.
And then we get the whole like creepy photographer moment, you know. I remember being kind of scared at that at first, but I feel like the something like The Descent does it better, yes, you know, and other things. Much. The Omen, obviously, very famously.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there are different takes with as technology evolves with this sort of thing where like you get the reveal in film or, you know, what you've captured and like it recontextualizes what's going on when you see, you know, but he is using like this digital camera and he can actually see what's going on with his Samara coming up behind him and possessing him.
Yeah.
You know, and it also provides some proof later on, but I don't know.
I'm just glad he has a hobby.
Sure. I mean, and he's just like, he's just creepy. Like he wasn't creepy to me in the first movie. He was creepy in this one, but of course he was getting possessed too. So
I don't know that he was really creepy in either one of them. Like, I feel like I've said that a lot about this kid after watching these movies, you know, throughout, you know, the rest of the 2000s so far. I'm like, oh, the creepy kid in that movie. He's really not. You're right. He's a normal kid. And the thing is that, like, as this movie starts to go on, I feel like he carries this fucking movie, you know? Like, he really is, like, acting well. He's doing the best that he can with what he's given to work with.
Well, he proved that he can do more than just stoic. Because when he cracks a smile, you know something's wrong.
Right. That's right. So he plays kind of this, like, not even kind of, he plays a dual role. And I think that he did a really, really good job in this movie.
He did.
When, like, in the last film, I was singing Naomi Watts' praises. Like, in this one, I'm like,
she falls a little flat compared to him. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean. And
but we also, like, know she didn't want to be there.
We also have people like Sissy Spacek and Elizabeth Perkins, who we have seen many, many times before the Ring TWO. And these are good, gifted actors. And it's just nothing. Like, they are outshined by this kid who just went on to become a lawyer.
Apparently.
Yeah.
And a Lannister guard.
Oh, that's right.
But then we get the fucking deer.
Oh, God.
Which, like, one shows up in the distance and kind of stares at him.
Yeah.
Like, randomly at, like, the swap meet or whatever the fuck it is. The county fair.
The county fair / antique
that they
mall.
Randomly go there when he's already getting sick.
I, like, know. She's like, you have hypothermia. Let's go to the county fair.
It's so random.
Do you want to ride something?
It's like, okay, I guess this was next in the script. You know, like, what the fuck? Did anyone, like, read this, like, and, like, put it at, maybe there was some sort of connective tissue they cut out.
I don't know. She lets him wander off.
She does. And finally finds him in the bathroom where he is, you know, now possessed. But the whole thing with the deer, like, it doesn't make sense to me. I kind of like the idea of it. Mm-hmm. And the execution's cool, too, I guess.
Yeah.
But it's like, if you're trying to be consistent with the lore, it's like this thing spooks them and makes them want to kill themselves. That's the whole lore.
That happened
with the videotape. It happened with Samara's story. It happened with the fairy ride that she takes in the first movie, yep, with the horse, famously. And it's like they want to attack and then they just want to stare, and it didn't make any fucking sense.
No. I mean, I think they were just, like, really trying to ramp up, like, the special effects, the CGI-ness of it all with that. And the thing is that, like, I'm sure at the time I was like, oh, my God, those deer.
No.
Today.
At the time, yeah. I remember thinking it looked hokey.
Oh, I mean, I can't remember. But honestly, last night I was just like, this looks stupid. Like, it doesn't look real at all.
Yeah.
And at first, like, it's also a really long scene. Like, the deer's there. It's sort of standing in the way, being sassy. But I will say that first impact on the driver's side,
yes,
I jumped.
Yes, jarring.
I was like, oh, you know?
I like the natural Dolby shocks.
Yes.
You know, because they didn't do a big music clang. It was actually just literally the impact into the car.
That and jumped then it me. Just goes on and on and on. And there's, like, 17,000 deer in the road, like, stopping them from driving.
And then Bambi is born. And then Dick Cheney comes and shoots.
Fucking Dick Cheney. He probably did shoot Bambi's mom. I mean, let's be real. He's the one who killed all of our childhoods. But yeah, by the time that they're finally driving off and the car is, like, a piece of shit at that point, but still magically, like, driving down the road, like, yeah, I'm just like, okay.
There's also some weird, like, CGI goofs too. Like, it was supposed to have broken the window. And the next scene, she turns around and her reflection is still on it, even though the window's broken digitally. Yeah.
Come on.
So,
and also, I mean, I feel like I said in the last episode, that's one of my favorite scenes of cinematography in that original movie. And I don't know if it's, like, actual or, like, CGI'd. I'm sure it's CGI'd, but, like, that horse's eye and the way that Naomi Watts' reflection is in it just looks really good.
No, I think that was photographed.
It's amazing looking to me. And then this is, like, a piece of shit comparatively. Yeah. I'm like, you have a really good moment with an actual animal in a movie.
Well, they go from this set piece to the next one, which is actually really good looking,
uh-huh,
and looks amazing and feels amazing. It's probably the best scene, or my favorite scene in the whole movie, as far as, like, how it looks and the reaction of it, which was putting Samara in water, which to me, I still don't like, because she's coming out of water. She uses water in her attacks.
Yeah.
You know, and water, she's basically lives in water. But for her to be afraid of it, like, it doesn't really match up for me. And yet this whole set piece looked amazing, which is the bathtub scene.
Yeah.
Where the water is all up on the ceiling and is, like, coming out of the tub in such a way that is almost, like, beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And it's all dripping upwards and everything else. And it looks totally surreal. And it actually looks real.
Yeah.
Like, still looks really good.
No, the water scene is really, really, because she walks into the bathroom and even she's like, oh, and then we're all treated to what it looks like, right? And it does. It looks like a fucking masterpiece of special effects.
Yeah. Certainly compared to the deer. And water's hard to do.
The things that happen after that, though, I mean, like Samara's body at that point, or standing in the tub, I'm like, okay, but...
She tries to drown Samara, who's dead. She obviously knew that her son was getting possessed, and yet she's drowning it, and then she walks in, and of course, it's the stupid, like, side plot of, like, her being an abusive mother, and, like, Max is kind of involved in that, and makes her go to the hospital, and, like, she should have been at the hospital anyway, and I don't know whose side I'm on, because she should be at the fucking hospital, but she's also not abusing.
No.
But yes, she is. By not taking him to the hospital. So I don't know. The film doesn't kind of know what it's doing at this point. I don't know. Like,
I mean, it's just like one moment after another is what this screenplay is. It's like, okay, we can do this. We can do this. We can do this.
Set piece to set piece without connective tissue.
For real. Because I feel like halfway through the movie, you pause it and you expect it to be almost over, right? This movie feels like ending. It feels like opening and then ending, like all the way through it.
Interesting.
Like, to me, it's just like action, 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 action. When the first movie kind of does that too, right? It seems like it's doing something, but it's building and building on top of itself. And we've talked about that many times on the podcast. Like, that is way more successful when things build on top of it, kind of like The Witch, yeah. Right? And I think that's what makes The Ring really successful, and what makes The Ring TWO terrible is that it's just like there's nothing that is happening.
It also doesn't learn from its own achievement, because if we skip to the end, because we've already talked about like the psychologist lady and like blah blah blah, and why aren't we going to the hospital, you know, why is she afraid of water, you know, we have her deciding that something's going to work. Oh, the well is open in her own psychic landscape, Samara's own fucking home
that she created.
And she closes the thing. Oh, now we're safe. Now she can't get out. You know, because she, you know, doesn't have telekinesis and everything else in her own, like, mindscape. Yeah.
What even is her power at this point?
Yeah. And so, you know, and then she kills herself, you know, drowns herself, I guess, to come wake up, because she decides that's going to work. And it does. The movie lets it happen.
Yeah.
In the first movie, she gets slapped down for that. What did you do? You weren't supposed to help her.
That's right.
You know, and it recontextualizes. It should have done that again. Mm-hmm. What are you thinking? Of course she could open that. That's her world. Yeah. She can go through that fucking thing whenever she wants. And I mean, of course she's not afraid of water. That was something else. You know, like, I would have loved that recontextualization that we got from the first movie to really echo that note. But that doesn't happen because, no. I don't know, reasons.
Obviously that's the only thing that they would do this
thematically
for.
That's what I wanted from a Ring movie.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to have some sort of, like, subvert, you know, of a trope that exists, right?
No, you're fucked. That's the point.
That is the point. And there's another movie after this, so it's still the point, which is, again, kind of why I want to watch Rings, as I want to, I can't remember. That movie was terrible. I blocked it out of my mind. But now I have to fucking know. I mean, she closed the well, and theoretically, that solved the problem. And it did from 2005 to 2017. But here we are. So...
Someone opened the well in the real life, I guess.
Something happened.
I'm going to be pissed off if that's actually what it is.
I can't. I swear to God it's on a plane. I can't remember. It's like
the well in the upside down.
Rings on a plane. I'm tired of these goddamn tapes on this motherfucking plane or whatever the fuck. I don't know. But I do like, and I don't know on your notes if this is it, when she's climbing up the well and she kicks a rock out and it beats her in the face. I started laughing at that too. She's like,
But they tried to have this Ripley moment too, where it doesn't quite work because Naomi is just like done. You can tell. Yeah. And she's like, puts the thing over the top of the capper on the top of the well. And she's like, I'm not your fucking mother. And I'm like, I didn't believe it. You don't believe it. I don't believe it.
Yeah. Even she's a believer. She's like, mommy. Right before she does it.
Get away from that TV, you bitch.
Please. Yeah, the entire ending is just fucking stupid to me. I don't know. And that's the thing, is we were talking off mic about like enjoying a movie that's bad because it's bad. Right. So I think back to like The Exorcist 2 that we had watched. Right?
Meanwhile, we're about to give our high ratings for this movie.
I know. And we gave Exorcist 2 like the shit most spectacular ratings ever. But I had a really good time watching Exorcist 2.
Because it was a shit show.
Yeah. It's a different kind of bad
and
movie.
It's so bad. It's good. Yeah. This isn't bad enough to be good, but it has good parts in it still.
It does. It's still a competently made movie.
Yes.
You know, and it doesn't look terrible.
A
it
lot
looks
of
good.
This is judging it not in a vacuum, but relative to its superior. And that's the problem with judging sequels, is like it's kind of an unfair competition, you know, against the one that came out first, if it's always better, you know?
Yeah.
So the ones that really succeed there, like Aliens or Godfather 2 or some other things, you know, mm-hmm. you know, that do really well, they're oftentimes lumped in with the first. And you always say the first two, you know?
That's true. Mm. I don't know.
Not in this case.
Nope. Oh, God. The Ring TWO. Do you have fun facts for me?
I kind of do. So first off, during the shooting of the carnival scene, locals mistook the set for an actual carnival and wandered in. They were actually included as extras in the film. Because why not?
Because reasons.
Well, they didn't know the angry Japanese guy yelling at them meant anything.
His translator was in break that time. I mean, in that neck of the woods, even you, if you were driving through Oregon and you saw some random county fair, an antique show, whatever the fuck that sign said, wouldn't you stop?
Probably. I don't know.
Yeah.
I was going on a road trip. But even with three artists, Kelly Stables, Samara's makeup took over 5 hours to complete.
How?
I don't know. I just feel like it's like hair on top of white face.
Yeah. They put on some like white makeup. They made her eye look a little extra angry and maybe a little withered from water and put hair in front of her. That took 5 hours.
I think it's because they have to do the fingers without the nails. They have to do the full arms and the full legs and the feet with the nails and like all that other stuff.
Oh, well, they wasted their time because you can't really see that very well.
She looks CG anyway.
Yeah.
Of, you know. But that was just like a really good.
Well, they do all that makeup and then they kind of make her look staticky in places.
Yeah. So they could have almost done anything. I don't know.
Oh, fuck.
So this was also the feature film debut of Mary Elizabeth Winstead, though she only appears in the unrated version. Theoretically, she plays the young Evelyn Borden. So she plays young Sissy Spacek's character.
What? She had.
Oh, it shows her from the back about to draw right. her baby. That's Mary Elizabeth Winstead. But you don't see her face because a lot of it was cut.
Does she have speaking moments?
I think so. A little bit.
Ooh.
Only like 30 seconds more. You know what I mean? But
yeah, but I still want to see
Elizabeth Winstead's first movie.
I love her.
Me too.
Now I want to see those scenes just for that.
So lastly, according to the production notes, there were bizarre incidents on set of life imitating art. So on the seventh day, the production office was discovered to have flooded overnight. The result was a burst water pipe. Water is a strong theme in the film, obviously. And in response, director Hideo Nakata requested a Japanese purification ceremony be carried out by a Shinto minister. But the strange incidents continued. While on location, a swarm of bees descended on the prop truck, prompting the immediate evacuation of the department before the bees left as quickly as they had arrived.
Ooh.
For no apparent reason, a 5-gallon water jug burst open in the production office kitchen, once again flooding the same room that had flooded earlier. One morning on the Universal lot, a set decorator stepped out of the parking garage to discover an antlered buck charging across the asphalt in her direction. Though deer are regular occurrences in the hills, the similarity of the deer attack in the film is uncanny.
Oh, I love shit like this.
I mean, too.
Oh, my God.
So it sounds like we should have made, like, The Ring 2 really should have been about the making of Ring 2. Get really fucking meta with it. Get Wes Craven to direct it or something.
Well, he can't anymore. That's sad.
In 2002, he could have.
That's true. And also, a fucking TV series called Cursed Films exists on Shudder. Why haven't we heard his information before?
Right.
Because this seems way more interesting than some of the shit they put on there.
For real.
My God. Maybe this should have been assigned to them to stop making this movie. They're like, what are we doing? Clearly, we're not supposed to do this. We were almost killed by bees.
This is cultural appropriation.
Stop. There are deer on the Universal lot. It is time to stop. But no, they didn't listen. And now we have this.
Yeah.
All right. Those were fun.
Thank you.
We have some questions to ask about The Ring TWO.
Oh, we do?
Yeah, as we do about every movie that we cover.
Oh, we do.
Film Flamers. That's right. It's shocking. Is this a horror movie?
Yes.
Yeah, I was scared completely. Well, that's the next question. Were you scared watching this movie?
No, not really.
Yeah.
I jumped a couple times.
Yeah, I mean, so like that deer made me jump. There's something else that made me jump. I can't remember what it was. The deer for sure, you know. But like other than that, and I can't fully remember my experience in the theater watching this because I hated this movie so much when it first came out. I feel like I liked it better this time than I did way back in 2005.
Me too, probably actually.
But like my expectations were kind of high.
Very high.
Yeah. So I did not find myself frightened. In fact, I kind of wanted it to just end the first time that I watched it.
Yeah.
So not scared, really. But out of 5 stars, what would you rate The Ring 2?
I rated it a 3.
I also rated it a 3. And I feel like I'm being very generous, but...
Yeah, I feel like I'm being a little generous too. You know, but there's some really cool stuff in here, you know?
Yeah.
And if I was going to take this movie in isolation, like if it was its own thing, I might have been a little bit kinder and give it a 3-star. You know, I feel like, especially compared to the first film, this is like a 2.5, but the first film's not perfect.
No, it's not.
You know, it's like a 4-star, right? And so I feel like being a 3-star here is generous, but it's just on the cusp, right? And so it's teetering on the edge of a 3, 2.5.
So you brought something interesting up. So if this movie existed on its own, if there were no original Ring, if this were The Ring, do you think this movie could stand alone? Do you think it explains enough of what happens in the original movie for this to exist by itself?
I think with a little bit of connective tissue, it could have.
Okay. All right. Well, that alone.
I don't know that it would be anything like a classic.
No.
But it would have been a 3-star movie.
But if you can make it through a plot without having to like really have something that came before it, if you explain it enough, it at least shows bones in a story.
We would remember it in the same way that we remembered Pulse, you know, true, or something, which is not much.
No, which is certainly not much.
We remember that it happened.
The American version.
Yeah.
Like, again, the Japanese versions of these movies, and I haven't seen the sequel to Ringu, right? I've only seen the first Japanese film. But like...
Well, that's the second one.
I mean, like, there's a Ringu 2, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, either way, like, the Japanese versions are almost always much, much better, clearly. So, I don't know. They strike a tone in their horror movies. So, Pulse, the Japanese movie, scary as fucking shit. The Maybe. American one, meh.
Yeah.
Finally, who's the hottest guy in Ring 2?
Scott Speedman. Oh, wait, a different 2000s guy. Simon Baker.
Scott Speedman, who is really hot, and Simon Baker wishes. I guess I kind of think that the fucking boyfriend or whatever teen from the opening scene is like the cutest, but that's the kind of guy that I was attracted to in 2005.
He was a little bitch.
I liked little like Pete Wentz bitches. I don't know. It's the fucking hair and the. Just watch the fucking tape. I don't know. The fuck. Either way,
you
again.
Closed your eyes. You were in the fucking kitchen, bitch.
You could have held her hand.
You could have been making her a sandwich.
I don't know. It's a toss-up, clearly, because, again, there's not a lot of options.
I might get a sandwich.
Okay, we didn't even, like, talk about that fully. But, okay, so she's making that fucking peanut butter and Vicodin sandwich. And she...
It sounds delicious.
I mean, it sounds very relaxing. And she's, like, spreading the jelly... And then she grabs what seems to be one pill out of the bottle and opens it. And it's this fucking cocaine mound of fucking Vicodin or whatever the fuck. And I was just like,
where is this coming from?
I know. It came out of one pill.
Was that thing under pressure or like what?
And then she doesn't like spread it out. She just like leaves it directly in the middle. And she's like, here you go. And the first bite apparently knocks the fucking kid out, even though all that mound of Vicodin is in the middle of the sandwich.
I know. Things like that annoy me.
And I never noticed shit like that. Normally, I'm just like, I didn't even know that Samara had a fucking psychic power until last week.
I just want to make like a more Muppety version of this where like he takes a bite where you can't see anything. And then it's like his whole face is like covered in powdered sugar.
I mean, it would have been easier to just give him a pill. I was just like, what is she doing all this for? And how long did it take to make that sandwich? Like, Samara knows what you're doing. She can control water at this point. She knows that you're making a Vicodin sandwich. Anyway, that's the hottest guy.
What?
I don't know. I'm just trying to wrap that segment up.
The pharmacist?
He's the smartest guy in this movie. I think that just about wraps up our conversation on The Ring 2. As always, we would like to know what you think about this movie. Did you love it? And what do you think about our conversation about it? You can tell us on social media at The Film Flamers on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and now Threads.
You can email us at tiredqueens@filmflamers.com or call our hotline at 972-666-7733. Call us Bambi and Thumper.
I'm Twitterpated.
I'm Threadipated.
I'm Threadipated. Follow the sound of my bones.
Close the cap on my well.
That's all of our Ring content on the main feed, but we still have to talk about the original Japanese Ringu over on Patreon. So head to patreon.com/theflimflamers, join the family over there, and listen to that bonus episode, vote in future polls, and check out all the bonus content that we have for you previously.
Yes, join us on Patreon to watch the second original Japanese Ringu.
Now you're
stop
just
saying original.
I can't help it. For all intents and purposes, it's the most popular.
Now I'm actually nerd.
Yeah,
when it comes to Ringu,
you've reached it.
God damn it!
And yet I'm the one who wants to watch all the things. I don't know. Also, as promised, back in A24 month, we have some new merch for you.
We do,
and it is highfalutin.
Yes, we have the highfalutin shirt and merch. We've got all kinds of shit for
that's
you.
Right.
So go to our store. You can go to our website at filmflamers.com. And click on the store link at the top, or I don't know, type in Film Flamers store into Google or something. You'll find it, and then you'll see it, and you'll get to whatever merch you want with whatever design you want, including highfalutin.
That's right,
on that store. So check it out. Yeah. So it's the Swedish Chef Muppet wearing the May Queen dress from Midsummer, and he's saying highfalutin.
Bork. Work indeed. Oh my god, guys, it's pretty fucking awesome. So do those things, and maybe I'll just post it on social media
before Disney swings the hammer.
They will hammer us to fucking death, just like they did to that poor man in Midsommar. Well, Chris, I am tired of looking up at the opening of this well. I need to go close it.
Sweet dreams.
I'm not your fucking mother.
I'm not your fucking daddy.
Goes around well.
Get me a bite of a sandwich.
That's what's for dinner tonight.